Joining us now in the studio is someone very familiar with PPPs. He is Alonzo Fulgham, the Chief Operating Officer of USAID Worldwide. Sir, welcome to the show.
How are you? Nice to see you.
Mr. Fulgham, one of your thrusts is public-private partnerships, or PPPs. Mm-hmm. Can you walk us through what they necessarily entail in the context of USAID?
Well, when you look at the President's priorities, President Aquino's priorities, our public-private partnerships address at least eight of the priorities that he's laid out. When you look at fiscal management, you look at food security, you look at education, those are the areas that we offer public-private partnerships in. I think they can be extremely successful in helping to move those agendas forward.
Okay, can you give us some examples of some very successful PPPs in the Philippines?
Absolutely. I just spent the last couple of days in Mindanao. The airport, General Santos Airport, is a prototypical type of partnership where the government came up with 33% of the financing, the U.S. government came up with 66%, and also the government provided the engineering and the technology as well to help build that airport. That airport also now has created downstream opportunities for the fisheries industry. You're not only exporting fish to Japan, but you're also now exporting it to the United States of America. That creates jobs, it creates economic growth, and makes families happy.
Okay. Given the huge budget deficit the Philippines is facing, the government is really banking on PPPs to help boost infrastructure. What do you think of this plan?
I applaud the president and embracing the private sector. I think that's very, very important. You have to remember that government doesn't produce jobs. The private sector does. The private sector is the engine to growth. I think that this is a good first step to extend your hand to create opportunities with the private sector so that we can identify economic growth and opportunities for the communities.
Okay. In the absence of funds, do you think PPPs are necessarily the best way for the government to drive development?
I think it's a first step, but I also think that we need to address the tax collection issue. Revenue is important so the government can provide services. I think the business environment is another area that the government has to continue to address with the legislature to identify key policies that are affecting foreign direct investment, as well as addressing the effects of these laws not being passed and then not being effective.
Okay, your PPPs with the government. How is the structure there?
The structure is, what we try to do is identify a demand that's in the strategy for the government and the community. For example, bridges. A couple of places that I visited in Mindanao, I had more than a half dozen people at each site come up to me personally and tell me how much these bridges or these roads that we've built, farm-to-market roads that we've built, in partnership with the community, providing 25% as well as goods and services to those projects, and they're now effective and now providing commerce, education, and opportunities to those communities that normally would not have had them. Those are so important to maintaining stability and community involvement in these projects.
That's very important. In your experience, what is the success rate of PPPs in the country, the ones that you've partaken in?
I think that what I found in my career, and I was really amazed in Mindanao with the amount of local involvement. I think that is the most important thing. I've met the mayor and the governor there, who are second to none of any of the governors and mayors I've met in a lot of the successful public-private partnerships, whereas they're involved, the community's involved, and they're ensuring that these projects are going to be sustainable and well-run. And most importantly, no corruption. I think that was one of the things that I liked the most about these projects, is that not only are they effective in the community, but we were able to not have to deal with the corruption problem.
Okay. Let's see. What are the pitfalls that can be avoided?
The pitfalls are public-private partnerships are not a silver bullet. They're an opportunity. They represent a piece of an overall government strategy on how to increase economic growth. And I think identifying projects just for projects, and if they're not well thought out and it's not demand-driven, then you won't have a successful partnership.
Okay. For the private sector to come in, usually there's a need for the financer to realize some sort of profit. Is there money being made in PPPs?
Absolutely. The private sector will not get involved just for philanthropy. They have to make a profit. They have a payroll they have to meet every week or every month. And that's why I said the most important thing in partnerships is we have to have mutual collaboration. It's got to be an overlapping issue that affects the private sector before they'll enter into those projects. That's why it's a partnership. And I think government engaging in those partnerships with the private sector, as I said, sends a signal to outside investors that the government is serious about involving the private sector and the long-term development, sustainable growth of the economy.
Okay. On another note, what is U.S. aid budget allocation for the Philippines?
Right now, it's about $87 million.
Okay, how does that compare to your budget for other developing countries in Southeast Asia?
Right now, the Philippines is number two in the region.
First being?
First being Indonesia.
Okay. 60% of the $87 million that goes to the Philippines, 60% of that goes directly to Mindanao.
Mm-hmm.
Why so?
Well, if you look at the economic indicators in Mindanao, six of the most troubled counties in Indonesia, or region in Indonesia, are in that region. And you look at the economic indicators on health, education, economic opportunities, they're dismal. And also we've been instructed by the government that this is an area that we should be working in, and it's also what we do as an agency. We work in the poorest of the poor areas. And I think also it provides an opportunity to continue to sustain the peace that the government fought so hard to put in place in Mindanao. And I think that as those indicators come back, and as I mentioned to the people that I've met over the last couple of days, those people have something to ensure that they don't want fighting to come back. They have something to hold on to. And as long as we continue that, I think that the opportunities are great. And who knows, in a few years you may have tourism there.
Okay, well, hopefully that would certainly be something to look forward to.
It's a beautiful part of the country and has a lot of potential. And I hope to see us continue to move forward and continue to stabilize it with the government and create economic opportunities for all in that region.
Okay, thank you for your time this evening, Mr. Fulgham. But most importantly, thank you for the assistance that you continue to extend to the country.
Philippines is a valued partner. You're welcome.
All right, we are taking another break. Please stay tuned. This is Business Nightly.